Hello, how are you today? Well, I'm back here, and now to talk about a very important topic. I think it's one of the most interesting topics that, you know, we're going to be dealing with in this course. And that is, as you saw before, the topic of sports. Yes, sports, you know, is wonderful. And we talk about, you know, the things that people, you know, love more around the world. We can talk about, you know, we can't forget to talk about sports. You know, sports, Olympic Games, the World Cup. You know, that's what attracts the attention of many people around the world. Well, I'm going to show you now what the topics will be today. I'm going to show you now, when you're watching now on the screen, the topics of today's lesson. We're going to be dealing with the English name of some Olympic sports. That will be one of our topics in this lesson. Number two, the borrowings from English, that is, palabras que son tomadas del inglés, borrowings from English used in the jargon of some sports, en la jerga. Y quiero aclarar que la palabra jargon en inglés, como pueden ver en la pantalla, esta palabra es equivalente a la palabra jerga, pero no tiene una connotación negativa, como pudiéramos pensar. Quizás algunas personas en español pensamos que hablar de jerga implica lenguaje demasiado coloquial. No se refiere a esto, sino que es el idioma, o sea, el vocabulario, términos que se utilizan en un área específica del conocimiento. And that's what we call the jargon of sports in general. Vamos a ver en la pantalla. So number two is borrowings from English used in the jargon of some sports. And number three is main communicative contexts in which it may be necessary to use English in the sphere of sports. Okay? We're going to talk today about different contexts, you know, different communicative situations in which English will be necessary when we talk about sports. Let us now go on with two very important questions for this lesson. The first question is, why are sports important? Okay? Maybe if you start thinking, you would say, well, sports are very important because when we practice sports, we're healthy. All right? We are healthy. I mean, our body is physically fit and, you know, we feel much better, you know, when we practice sports than when we don't practice sports. But that is not the intention of this question today. When you read now the next, you know, slide, you will see that we have here some other reasons why sports are important. Okay, and the second question is, what role does English play in the world of sports? I mean, do you think English is important when we talk about sports? I mean, international sports? But also when we talk about sports in Cuba, using Spanish. I mean, as you know very well, we use in Spanish a lot of terms from English to talk about certain sports disciplines, all right? Well, today we're going to be dealing with that, among other things. Let us now read the following paragraph, and I'm sure you will find here the answer to the two questions you had before. Remember, the first question was, it was about the importance of sports, and number two, it had to do with the role that is played by English as a language in international communication in this world of sports. And maybe you want to copy it. The practice of sports has become a means to strengthening bonds of friendship and understanding among people from every country in the world. All right? Here you have maybe words you don't know the meaning of. Strengthening, una palabra que tiene una ortografía bien compleja. Esta palabra significa fortalecimiento, o sea, son el fortalecimiento de los lazos de amistad. Esa expresión que tenemos aquí, strengthening bonds of friendship and understanding. Un medio para, una vía para el fortalecimiento de los lazos de amistad y de comprensión. Y el resto de las palabras ustedes la conocen. All right? So again, the practice of sports has become a means to strengthening bonds of friendship and understanding among people from every country in the world. That, I would say, would be the answer to our first question. Why are sports important? All right? And we know that, I mean, as I said before, there are many other reasons why we believe that sports are important. Having to do with health, we know with also, I mean, helping people not to get sick or whatever. But here we have a reason that has a broader, I would say, connotation. That is, this having to do with the relationship, you know, among people from different parts of the world. The second part of this paragraph includes, I would say, the answer to the second question. Let's go now back to the screen. The second part reads like this. Communication in sports has been made much easier with the use of the English language. And here we have a very, I would say, interesting structure of the English language, that is the combination of passive voice with present perfect. Where is it? Let's see. Vamos a analizar aquí una estructura que es muy importante, una estructura que aquí combina dos elementos importantes desde el punto de vista estructural de la lengua inglesa, que son la famosa voz pasiva, que iremos trabajando en esta serie de clases que vamos a tener sobre los temas de deporte. O sea, no va a ser solamente esta clase, hoy tendremos varias clases más en las que ustedes disfrutarán, pienso yo, de este atractivo tema. Y aquí se combina la voz pasiva con el llamado present perfect, que es el equivalente desde el punto de vista estructural al antepresente del español. So then we have communication in sports has been made. And that is what we have here. You know, it has been made is a combination of passive voice, and we know it is passive voice because we have been. And then we have the participle made. And we know it is present perfect because we have has, and then we have the participle of the verb to be. So then, communication in sports has been made much easier, mucho más fácil. Fíjense una manera de poder hacer énfasis en el grado de facilidad. Cuando uno dice easier, dice más fácil. Cuando dice much easier, mucho más fácil. Aquí no utilizamos la palabra more porque ya, como ustedes pueden ver, easy is turned into easier just by adding er at the end, and we don't here add more at the beginning. All right? So then, with the use of the English language, that is the answer to the second question. But I want to show you now some other examples of the same combination of structures, that is passive voice with present perfect. These two structures combined are going to be very useful along this set of lessons that you're going to be having about English and sports. And you'll see here some examples in the field of sports. And we have also here the structure, that is subject. Fíjense aquí la estructura sujeto, y la tienen como si fuera una fórmula matemática, que a veces necesitamos utilizar estas fórmulas matemáticas para poder hacer las explicaciones gramaticales. Sería subject plus have or has, depending on the subject, plus been plus the past participle. And notice we say here been. Yo quisiera que ahora tomaran al profesor. Been. Esa palabra, ese participio que significa es el equivalente a sido en español, se pronuncia been. Y usted dirá, ¿por qué está pronunciando una I más corta y más relajada cuando tenemos dos letras? O sea, ustedes han sacado una conclusión en las clases de los cursos que hemos dado de que cuando aparecen dos vocales escritas, o sea, dos letras que representan a las vocales, pues generalmente nosotros pronunciamos una I más tensa y más larga y diríamos entonces been. Pero si decimos been, estamos diciendo frijol, que es una palabra que también tiene dos letras de vocales como la E y la A, pero en este caso lo pronunciamos con una I más corta. Sería exactamente así. Been. Been. ¿Ok? So then we go back to the screen. Subject plus have or has plus been plus the past participle. And here we have six examples. Number one is the one we had here in the previous slide. Communication has been made much easier. O sea, se ha facilitado la comunicación mucho más, se ha hecho mucho más fácil la comunicación. Y fíjense que en español lo digo, se ha hecho, porque utilizamos una estructura propia de la lengua española que es la llamada pasiva con C. Es decir, se comienza utilizando C. Se ha hecho más fácil. Normalmente no diríamos en español la comunicación ha sido hecha más fácil, porque normalmente en español no hablamos así, porque las lenguas tienen sus diferencias a la hora de organizar los elementos en la sintaxis de una oración, y el español tiene otro orden. Por lo tanto, en español diríamos se ha hecho más fácil la comunicación. We go now to number two. The game has been rained out. And here What we're saying is, el juego se ha suspendido por lluvia. It's very typical of baseball, all right? So the game has been rained out. You may also say, the game has been rained off. So these are two possible ways we have in English to talk about a game that has not been able to, you know, we haven't been able to finish because it's been raining, all right? Number three, the competitor has been disqualified. We know that there are many reasons why a competitor can be disqualified in a certain sport, all right? Like maybe because this competitor was on drugs, or maybe he did things that he was not supposed to do, like somebody running in athletics and then he pushes one of the competitors, and then of course this competitor who pushed the other one will be disqualified in most cases. So let's go back to the screen now because I want you to have time to copy. So again, number one is communication has been made much easier. Number two, the game has been rained out. Rained out, okay? Number three, the competitor has been disqualified. The competitor has been disqualified. And look at the spelling of disqualified. And then also notice the ending. Rained, ed, because rain is a regular verb. And also in the case of disqualify, we have disqualified with ed, because this is also a regular verb. Okay? Number four, the players have been introduced. Maybe you saw the World Cup in South Africa a few months ago, and you saw that at the beginning of each of the games, each of the football games, all the participants, all the competitors, all the players were introduced to the public. That's what's happening here, okay? Let's go back. The players have been introduced. Sería aquí como se han presentado los jugadores. También podría usted decir los jugadores han sido presentados. That's also possible. Number five, most athletes have been tested for alcohol. You know that, you know, in many international competitions, competitors, athletes in general, they're tested for doping, but also now in many sports for alcohol. All right? So se le han hecho pruebas de alcohol a la mayoría de los atletas. Y fíjense el comienzo, most athletes. Most athletes is the beginning. Okay? La mayoría de los atletas, y digo most athletes. Number six, an announcement has been made. Se ha hecho un anuncio. Fíjense que en muchos casos comienzo el español con C. Okay, so these are six examples of the use of the passive voice in combination with present perfect to talk about sports, okay, in English. Let us now go a little bit more, I mean, show you more information about the English language and its role in international sports. Look at this. English is the official language of several international sports federations. The official language. Es un idioma oficial que cada federación tiene. En la mayoría de los casos, el inglés. And we have here some examples like athletics, archery, boxing, basketball, shooting, swimming, gymnastics, wrestling, cycling, and many others. And now is the time for you to learn how to say in English, you know, the name of many of the Olympic sports. Let's see now. A very important sport in Cuba is boxing. We have won a lot of gold medals at the Olympic Games in this sport. And we have a picture here of, I would say, the best Cuban boxer ever, Teofilo Stevenson, who was the Olympic champion in 1972, 76 and 1980 at three Olympic Games. All right? Boxing. Look at the spelling of that sport. Number two is archery. Look at this beautiful picture of a Chinese archer. She was the Olympic champion in Beijing 2008. And look at the arrow in the air. It's a very nice picture showing you the beauty of this sport. So far we have boxing, archery, and here we come to baseball. Baseball is a sport. You know, it's our national sport. Unfortunately, it will not be in the Olympic Games anymore in London. There will be no baseball. So the last time it was in the Olympic program was in Beijing 2008. Number four is gymnastics. And look at the spelling of gymnastics. It's G-Y. Gymnastics. This is a Chinese competitor at the Olympic Games in the parallel bars. This is one of the events of the sport of gymnastics. Number four is cycling. And cycling is a sport that is practiced both by men and women, just in the case of archery so far. I know there's some boxing, but I don't think this is a nice sport for women anyway. But going to cycling here, though in this picture we see here men, you know, riding their bicycles, it is a sport practiced by both men and women. And I'd like you to see now on the board how we say in English femenino y masculino. Then we talk about women's cycling, okay, women's cycling and men's cycling. So we use what? Women, es plural para mujer, serían mujeres, pero cuando nosotros colocamos women apostrophe S, then we're indicating, like in Spanish we would say, femenino. We know that we also have female and male, but we don't use these terms in international sports. We talk about women's cycling and men's cycling. And we'll see soon some other sports which are practiced by both men and women. All right? So going back now to the screen, we've seen cycling, and now we're going to look at football. Football, also practiced by men and women. But of course, traditionally, it's been men who've been practicing this sport for many years, and I would say it's the most popular sport in the world. It's easy to practice it, and every continent has very strong teams in football, all right? We saw that at the World Cup in South Africa early this year, all right? So, a beautiful sport, rhythmic gymnastics. This is one of the sports that is only practiced by women. I mean, I don't know if we have any competition, any men's event in this sports, but I don't think we do, right? It's rhythmic gymnastics. And look at the spelling of rhythmic. Lots of, you know, strange combinations of letters in rhythmic. R-H-Y-T-H-M-I-C. Difficult. And it is pronounced like this, rhythmic. Sería bueno que pudieran ver ahora la pronunciación. Ustedes saben que cuando nosotros trabajamos con el sonido, o sea, cuando el sonido se representa con las letras TH en inglés, generalmente se pronuncia con la lengua hacia afuera. Y aquí tenemos un ejemplo, sería así. Rhythmic. Rhythmic gymnastics. All right? That's the way it is. All right? It's a beautiful sport, as I said before, practiced only by women. I think it's one of two sports, you know, practiced only by women, internationally speaking. Then we have swimming, another beautiful sport. I would say is the second most important sport in the Olympic program because, you know, of the number of events and the attraction that it causes on television, you know. So swimming and athletics are, I would say, the most important sports in the Olympic program. And you know why? I mean, you know what? They do this at every Olympic Games. The games begin with swimming, and the athletics competition does not start until swimming is over, so they do not overlap, okay? They do not overlap. Swimming first and then athletics at the end, so that there's, you know, this attraction, this interest on the Olympic Games all throughout the games, all right? So then, swimming is one of the important ones. Athletics. Well, we know that we have a lot of events in the athletics competitions, all right? We have what we call the track events, los eventos de pista. There are many, many track events. We have also the events on the field, that is, you know, jumps and, you know, throwings and all that. And we're going to have some time along this series of lessons, you know, to talk about athletics, you know, more deeply, all right? It's one of the, as you know very well, one of the sports that has, you know, one of the sports that have brought a lot of happiness to Cuba in the Olympic Games, all right? So rowing, and rowing is remos, but some people believe that rowing also includes canoeing and kayak, and that's not so. These are different sports, all right? Fíjense que este es el remo, y voy a escribir en la pizarra cómo se escribe canotaje. All right? So, rowing is a sport and canoeing is a different sport. They're similar sports, but not the same.
Canotaje, porque el canotaje incluye, ¿qué incluye el canotaje? La canoa y el kayak. Y voy a explicar rápidamente la diferencia entre uno y el otro, muy general. Ustedes verán en la foto que tienen en la pantalla, que en el caso del remo, los remos están unidos a la embarcación. Y eso no pasa así en el kayak y la canoa, que los remos están totalmente en las manos de los deportistas, no están atados de ninguna manera a las embarcaciones. Se podrán dar cuenta entonces que es la razón fundamental quizás por la que son eventos deportivos diferentes. All right?
So we talk about different sports. So we have canoeing here and we have rowing here on the screen. All right? But remos is a sport, rowing. But what do we call the instrument? El remo en sí que se utiliza. That's not a row, it's an oar. All right? So the oar is the instrument that they use, you know, to paddle, you know, when they are trying to move ahead with their, you know, small boat. All right? So, oar, el remo, el instrumento, and rowing is the sport of, you know, rowing, that is remos. All right? Good. Let's go on. Table tennis, a nice sport, which is dominated by the Asians, you know, at every important event. The Chinese, you know, the Koreans are very good at this sport. And it is also called ping pong, also in English. I suppose that the word comes from, you know, some of the Chinese languages, you know, the languages spoken in China. Ping pong or table tennis. When you look at the schedule of the Olympic Games, you won't see ping pong. They will call it table tennis. All right? Good. Let's see now. We have shooting here. Shooting is also a very important event at the Olympics. I believe it's been at the Olympic Games for many, many years. And there are three types of, let's say, events in shooting. All right? We have the rifle events, like this one here on the screen. Fíjense que este es un evento que se llama carabina, but we call it in English rifle. Se parece mucho al español. Vamos a ver dónde lo podemos escribir aquí para que ustedes no se pierdan. We have rifle events, we have pistol events, and we have the famous shotguns, the shotgun events. Estos son los eventos de escopeta, de carabina y de pistola. Three different kinds of equipment, of weapons, all right, in general. All right? So then, what we're showing here on the screen is only one of the three, I would say, most general, you know, events that we have in shooting, which is rifle. This is air rifle. Esa es la carabina neumática. Air rifle is what we have here on the screen. Okay? Let's go ahead. Then we have volleyball. Mm-hmm. And this is also a beautiful sport. You know, that Cuba has won three gold medals at the Olympic Games in volleyball. Barcelona 92, Atlanta 96, and then Sydney 2000. The Cuban team won the gold medal there, and well, they were well known around the world as the best team ever in international women's volleyball. It's again a sport practiced by both men and women. So we have women's volleyball and we have men's volleyball. All right? Good. Now, weightlifting. And here we have a woman practicing this event as a competitor at the Olympic Games, as a Chinese competitor. And this is women's weightlifting, but we do also have men's weightlifting, of course. So it was originally only a sport for men, and now it is both for men and women. Okay? So I suppose you've been copying, you know, the names of the sports, so that you have now, I would say, an almost complete list of all the sports which are in the Olympic program at present. Okay? Then we have the second sport that is practiced only by women, and that is synchronized swimming. Another beautiful sport. Some people believe it is not a sport, but it is almost like dancing. I think it's a beautiful combination of sports and music and dancing and all that, which is admired by a lot of people on television, and also when they go to the, you know, the halls or, you know, the pools where this sport is practiced. and it attracts the attention of many spectators and also televiewers in different parts of the world, you know, when the Olympic Games are being held. All right, let's continue then. We have basketball, okay? And this is one of the names of the sports that is a combination of two words, and then we understand the meaning of the whole thing by knowing the meaning of the two components, and that's basketball. Basket, cesto o cesta, and then ball, pelota. We have baseball, es la pelota y las bases, son características, o sea, palabras que caracterizan el deporte. Baseball, football, la pelota y los pies o el pie. En este caso, volleyball, es la pelota y el voleo de la pelota en el aire. Basketball, we have it here. We have handball, que no lo tenemos en esta lista, que es el balonmano, que también entonces es el balón y la mano. Handball. Weightlifting, also the combination of weight and lifting. So it's easier, you know, when we have sports with these names to understand, you know, the actual meaning of the name of the sport. All right? Vamos a ver en la pantalla nuevamente para que copien el nombre del deporte. Basketball. All right? Okay. Equestrian. This is a sport that combines, you know, two brains. You know, the brain of a human being and the brain and the skills of a horse. I think it's a beautiful sport as well. Okay? Equestrian. Diving. Look at this. Diving is also a beautiful sport that is followed by many people around the world. And when we talk about diving, we talk about two main events. Is the springboard, el trampolín, and the platform. So these two are the ones that we, you know, in most cases have. It's a springboard, trampolín, and then the platform. So, springboard, trampolín, platform, and these mean that the springboard and the platform are, you know, positioned at different heights, but we'll talk about these, you know, events more deeply in the future. And you know that we have, as we can see here on the screen, we have the so-called synchronized diving. That is a combination of two divers at the same time trying to do the same, and of course they get, you know, certain, you know, marks, a number of points, a score, depending on their skills and their performance. All right, let's go on. Then we have wrestling. La lucha, all right? Wrestling, lucha, there may be of two types. We have synchronized, sorry, we have, we're talking about freestyle wrestling, la lucha libre, freestyle wrestling, and we also have the Greco-Roman or classical wrestling in which you cannot use your feet or your legs, it's only your arms, you know, what you can use there. All right, then water polo, another sport that is practiced in a swimming pool. Water polo, it can be both men's water polo and women's water polo, all right? We used to have a very good team, a very good men's water polo team in the 1970s and 80s, winning also medals at world championships many years ago. Tennis, also called the white sport because of the uniform that they wear. We have here, you know, a picture of a double, you know, a match of doubles here. Two men. We also have the mixed doubles as well, but not in this case on the picture. Fencing, one of the oldest sports in the Olympic program. And maybe you know that Cuba won its first gold medal at the Olympic Games in this sport. And it was won by Ramon Fons many, many years ago. All right? So fencing is one of the traditional sports. And then we have judo. Judo, whose name comes from Japanese, but it is, you know, the same in English and in Spanish. Okay. So I have shown you a number of sports, and we're going to be dealing with some of them in future lessons more deeply. Of course, we're going to talk about baseball, you know that, and some other maybe not so, you know, commonly followed sports. We're going to be dealing with them here as well. Now, English is the preferred means of interaction among athletes, coaches, judges, and referees, and team officials around the world. And why do I want you to have this?
Y ahora quiero que copien, que ahora no es importante que el profesor saque en pantalla, sino lo que está en la diapositiva.
English is the preferred means of interaction among athletes. And I want you to copy the word athletes. Look at the spelling of it. Coaches, judges, and referees. What is the difference?
Los jueces y los árbitros en general, referees, ¿verdad? En algunos deportes se utiliza árbitro, otros utilizan jueces, en dependencia de la función que hacen. El juez es el que gana la nota, califica, el árbitro hace otras funciones, tiene a veces que interferir entre el boxeo, otros deportes así de combate, pues entonces se utiliza más la palabra referee,
and team officials around the world. So I wanted to copy this because we have here important words like athletes, coaches, judges and referees, and team officials. Now, some people would maybe want to copy this while I talk. Some people are, they believe that a coach and a trainer are the same, and they are not. A coach is one thing, and a trainer is a different thing. Sometimes the same person does both jobs. What is a trainer?
Es un preparador físico.
El trainer,
vamos a escribir en la pizarra, porque son palabras que a veces confundimos.
Trainer, over here, the trainer es el preparador físico. And the coach does a lot more than that. The coach has to do with the technical preparation of the athlete. Sometimes this person also has to do with the mental training of the athlete. His mental is everything. So the coach has, I would say, a more comprehensive job than the trainer. So please do not confuse or do not use one word instead of the other, because they have different, meanings, and of course, the meaning is based on their functions, okay? So then, let's go back. So again, athletes, coaches, judges, and referees, and team officials around the world, okay? I'm sure you had time to copy this because, it's not long, and we're going to go on now. Now, look at this. What is the main idea here? The main idea here is that a lot of terms, there's a lot of terminology which is specific to sports that comes from English. In many sports, we have terms that we use in Spanish that come from the English language. And that is because maybe some of these sports were, first played in English-speaking countries. Another reason may be that some of these sports, or many of these sports, have their rules written in English. And for that reason, when a new rule comes, it first appears in the rules, in the rules books of these international federations, the names come in English. And it is difficult for people sometimes to find an equivalent in their own languages. And for that reason, we sometimes try to keep the English words and we use them, in our case in Spanish, to talk about, sports and to talk about certain rules in certain sports. And we're going to show you now some examples. All right? Look at this. Which sports are these words used in? Okay?
Y aquí se nos corrió un poquito, pero bueno, de todas maneras ustedes lo pueden ver bien.
Strike. ¿En qué deporte usamos strike? When do we use strike? Okay? I'm sure you know that.
Dos strike y tres bolas, strike. Y a veces decimos strike en español, porque bueno, tampoco podemos aspirar que la persona que habla español, pues entonces lo pronuncie exactamente como es en inglés, porque para eso están los ingleses, o los que hablan inglés en sus países, que lo hablen, lo digan perfectamente.
Now, strike comes from that, from English. Strike, and we have the word performance. Que muchas veces los comentaristas, incluso los periodistas que escriben, hablan de un performance, y lo utilizan como en español. Pero es una palabra que se usa mucho en inglés, performance, and it means rendimiento, actuación of a certain athlete in a certain competition. I think it's more important now that you look at the screen, okay, because all the information is here. I'm going to be speaking at the same time as you copy. So then, strike from English, performance as well from English, out. Well, I don't think I need to explain this one. It is a baseball word. Goal.
Decimos en español gol, pero eso viene del inglés, la palabra goal, que es la portería. Pero también cuando usted, you score a goal, it means that the ball that was kicked by one of the players, you know, went inside the goal. And for that reason, it is called a goal. And everybody gets so happy, you know, when this happens, because, you know, they've been running for 90 minutes, and then all of a sudden, you have a goal. All right, maybe it's 1-0, 1-1. It's a very, you know, low score, but people get so excited when this happens, you know, in football. Now, set. A set is used, a word used in volleyball, in also many other sports, now in archery as well, in tennis. We have the net. A net is what, you know, la net en el voleibol, en el tenis. A match, similar to what we say in Spanish. Y usted dirá, esta palabra que se escribe, umpire, ¿qué quiere decir? Es the umpire. Y de ahí viene la palabra umpire, que se utiliza mucho en español para referirse al árbitro de béisbol. That's the umpire. That's the way it is pronounced in English, the umpire. Then we have fly. Un fly es una, o sea, cuando le dan con el bate, pues la bola que va alta. Referee, ya lo utilizamos. Swing, also a baseball word. Record, it is used in many of the sports. Like, for example, weightlifting, shooting, archery, athletics, okay, cycling, they have records. All around is used in gymnastics. You know, it's a combination of several events. When you add the score, when you add the points that a gymnast has achieved in all of the events, then he's the winner of the all-around event. Okay? And you have it there on the screen. Let's see. All-around, and we have a penalty. El penalti famoso del fútbol. It is, in English, a penalty. So I'm going to read them all again. Strike, performance, out, goal, set, net, match, umpire, fly, referee, swing, record, all around, and penalty. And we have now some more. Then we have a tie break. Tie break. A veces algunos de nuestros comentaristas que lo tratan de decir parecido al inglés no pronuncian bien el break. Tampoco tienen que decirlo como en el inglés. Estamos seguros de eso, pero es break, no tie break, como a veces dicen. Tie break, team, a word from English, single, it's an event. You have, for example, singles in table tennis, you have it in tennis. It means also, in other sports, it means that there's only one player competing at a time. Okay, we have tennis, you know, the sport of tennis. It takes a double N in English. Score, el resultado, el score. Muchas veces lo dicen los que narran béisbol. Score. Home run, el jonrón. Home run, the uppercut. En boxeo es un gancho, ¿verdad? Cuando los comentaristas hablan de un gancho, a veces dicen el uppercut de izquierda, el uppercut de derecha, y eso es una palabra que viene del inglés, que es uppercut, ¿verdad? So again, left field, it could have been center field, right field, son los jardineros izquierdo, derecho, o central, en este caso izquierdo, left field. Coach, we talked about this word already. Leader, similar to Spanish. The roster. El roster es la lista de todos los jugadores que están en un equipo. Por ejemplo, un roster de pelota tiene los 25 según el determinado evento que sea, peloteros que están, que no son los que realmente van a jugar ese día, porque eso es el lineup. Lineup, que aparece aquí también en pantalla, es la alineación. So it's in roster and lineup. The roster includes all the players in the team. And the lineup includes only the ones who are going to be playing today. All right? The dugout, el dogao. Eso que en español se decimos que donde están los peloteros ahí, is the dugout. And offside is a term used in football. Okay? Que se llama en español a veces fuera de juego. It's the offside. Okay. We have some more. The knockout in boxing. El knockout, el boxeo. Miren cómo se dice y se escribe en inglés. Knockout. A sprinter is a runner in the short distances, a sprinter. Then a playoff, esto es una palabra que también se usa mucho en la pelota cubana, se diría correctamente en inglés, playoff, o sea, ese off es con O, aunque por supuesto nosotros cuando lo decimos en español decimos el playoff y está perfecto, porque estamos haciendo una adaptación de una palabra que estamos tomando prestada de otra lengua y la usamos en nuestra lengua materna. Okay? Hit, a word also we use in baseball. Foul. El foul es después de dos strikes un foul y no cuenta otro strike, eso lo sabemos todo de béisbol. Corner is a word of football. Dribbling and basketball. El dribbling del baloncesto, ¿saben? Todo el mundo me imagino que sepa lo que es eso. Fair play. Fair play es juego limpio. It's used now, you know, there's a lot of, let's say, importance attached to this word and, you know, and the concept behind fair play now internationally. Average, el averaje, lo decimos tal y como se escribe. You know, it's a baseball word. Ring in boxing. Doping. Doping, I think all of us know. And look at the word doping, it takes only one P. Sometimes I've seen it with two P's, but that is incorrect. It is doping with only one P. The photo finish, it is used in athletics to determine the winner of a race. The pivot in basketball. Pivot is very often the tallest player in the team. Skeet is a word of shooting, you know, shotgun, shooting, skeet, you know, they should have, they shoot at clay targets, you know, the skeet competitors, they shoot at clay targets, and that's a word that we use in shooting. Pitcher and catcher, these are words that we use in baseball. So it's only to give you an idea of how many words we use in Spanish that come from English. And these are terms that are used mainly in sports. Let's see now some of the contexts in which we're going to find English in the next few lessons. In our next few lessons, we're going to be talking about winning and losing in sports. All right? We're going to show you, we're going to teach you how to understand a reading text or maybe a listening text in which people talk about or write about winning and losing in sports. And look at the word losing with only one S. All right? So winning and losing in sports. Number two is talking about a training routine. All right? So then, when we talk about a training routine, it means that we're going to talk about what an athlete does every day or weekly to prepare for an event. That is their training, you know, routine on a daily basis. That is, for example, in the morning, they lift weights. In the afternoon, they do, you know, technical preparation. In the evening, they do some other things. All right? So then, this is one of the things we're going to be talking about. Again, number one is talking about winning and losing in sports. Number two is talking about a training routine. Number three, talking about the schedule of a sports event. And when we talk about the schedule, you're going to find that the word schedule has two pronunciations. One is the typical American one. When I say schedule, that is what he said. You know, when we are using American English, we use the word schedule. It's the same word when you see it written down, but it has a different pronunciation. But it's the same word. En el inglés norteamericano se diría schedule. En el inglés británico sería schedule. Schedule. Same words, same spelling, same meaning, different pronunciations. All right? So you may find it, you know, in the two ways, the schedule and schedule. Schedule, American, schedule, British. All right? I think this is not the first time we have been talking about differences between English in the United States or in North America in general and English in the UK. So it's one more example of differences between the two variants of English, the two main variants of English, all right? Number four, describing a sports facility. What is the meaning of facility? Facility no significa facilidad. Y a veces pasa, sobre todo en países como Puerto Rico, que hay tanta influencia de la lengua inglesa, donde me hablan de las facilidades. Y entonces dicen que vamos a visitar una facilidad deportiva y se trata de una instalación deportiva. So the word facility means instalación when we talk about sports, okay? We're talking about different sports facilities. Maybe we're going to talk about sports facilities maybe in Cuba, maybe in other countries. And that's one of the
contexts in which we're going to be using English in the next few lessons. Number five is narrating a sports event. That's very difficult. I mean, the people who do this in Cuba and in many other countries do a very difficult job, because when you narrate on the radio, it may be a little, I would say, a little easier, because, you know, the spectators are not watching what you're talking about. And so, but when you're doing that on television, it's, I would say, very difficult, because the people, you know, are watching the same thing as you're watching, and you're telling them what's going on, but they're watching what's going on at the same time. So if you make a mistake, they're going to realize, all right? But it is difficult because you need to know a lot about many sports. I mean, it is not easy to narrate baseball now, football tomorrow, weightlifting the day after tomorrow. So each of the sports in the Olympic program has, you know, rules and regulations and things that, you know, would make narrating this sport very difficult for somebody who is not an expert, all right? So far we have five possible contexts in which we're going to find English in the world of sports. Number one is, again, winning and losing. Number two, talking about a training routine. Number three, the schedule of sports events. Number four, you know, a sports facility and what it is like. And number five, a sports event, that is narrating, that is what's going on now. Okay, then some more when we talk about records. And we're going to learn here, you know, how to talk about records, a record that was broken, that was set. And we're going to be using, of course, here also the passive voice to talk about records. I'm sure some of you know that many years ago a Cuban runner, Alberto Juan Torena, broke world records and also Olympic records. All right, so then we have here talking about an athlete's sports career. We're going to talk about somebody, you know, a famous athlete and all of his sports career and all that. Maybe I think it's good for you to copy. Vamos a copiar lo que está en la pizarra, en la pantalla, por favor. So, talking about an athlete's sports career, talking about physical exercise, en general ejercicio físico, talking about an athlete's daily routine. So, these are some of the things we're going to be doing here in the next few lessons, and I have some more here. Asking for and giving general information about sports in the Olympic program. We're going to talk about that. Talking about the rules which govern certain sports disciplines. Of course, very general rules, because we're not experts, okay? Number three, talking about injuries and lesions, right? What is the meaning of injury? Lesiones en general, okay? And number four, talking about sports for the disabled. Y fíjense el término disabled, deportes para discapacitados. Ya no se habla otros términos que se utilizaban en inglés como handicapped. That's not a nice word to use now. Not anymore. The physically impaired. These are terms we don't use anymore, you know, in international sports. What they do is they talk about sports for the disabled. Okay? And they say somebody's disabled and the, you know, the those who are not disabled are able-bodied competitors. We're going to talk about that in the future. I have a homework for you. Okay, here I have a homework that has to do with the use of the present perfect and the passive voice together. I wanted to copy the homework. Vamos a dar unos segunditos para que copien la tarea y eso la voy a ir explicando mientras ustedes van escribiendo. Copien solamente y lo que tienen en paréntesis es el verbo que yo quiero que utilicen, porque puede ser que usted no conozca el verbo, pero sí conoce el resto de la información. Then you would say, I would say, translate into English. Los Juegos Olímpicos nunca se han celebrado en África. Creo que todos estamos de acuerdo con eso. And we're going to talk about this in our next lesson, that is, where the Olympic Games have been held. And I wanted to use the verb hold, but hold is a simple form. You have to use the participle. And which is the participle of hold? Held. Okay? So the Olympic Games, and then you go on. Los Juegos Olímpicos nunca se han celebrado en África. Number two, el béisbol ha sido excluido del programa olímpico para Londres 2012. Fíjense que es la misma estructura,
nunca se han celebrado, ha sido excluido. And number three, lo han ponchado 3 veces en este juego. Poor player. And the verb is to strike out. So here we have 3 verbs, hold, exclude, and strike out. And what you have to do is translate into English these sentences using the passive voice in combination with present perfect. Okay?
Un minutico para que copien la tarea entonces. Le ponemos un poquito de música y ustedes copian la tarea. Adelante.
So all of you copy that. Of course, the Olympic Games, never in Africa yet, but maybe soon. Why not? Yes. And then, well, I have to say goodbye. It's been all for today. I hope you enjoyed the lesson. I did enjoy the lesson a lot. And well, we're going to be talking about sports in our next lesson as well. Have a good day and enjoy the homework. Goodbye.